Hello, Finman 4 students! Welcome sa ating kauna-unahang topic na pag-uusapan sa ating subject entitled Monetary Policy and Central Banking. So, for our first topic, the title is actually Introduction to Central Banking. So, obviously, the cover photo of my slides is showing or I've used the latest logo of the Banko Sentral ng Pilipinas. Kasi hanggang mamaya, no, ito ang magiging center ng ating discussion. So, konting heads up lang, ano, later on, as I continue with my discussion, in between the slides, there would be questions na ipopost ko for the sake of me knowing whether you have picked up some information that needs your affirmation, no, kung na-pick up ba yung or na-comprehend ba yung information na diniscuss ni ma'am. And some of the questions will be used for your offline activity. So, please make sure wala kayong mamimiss na slides, although some of you would prefer to fast-forward some of the topics which you think is already familiar with you. So, careful na lang, no, even as you brush through the entire lecture. Kasi alam ko naman ang unang agenda nyo would be the length of this lecture. Pag nakita nyong very lengthy siya, baka mamili na lang kayo or mag-handpick ng topics which you think is more interesting on your part. So, careful lang tayo ha. Baka may mamiss kayong mga questions na kailangan nyo palang sagutan. And aside from that, there is going to be an end of the chapter review questions which will be answered via Microsoft Forms. And the link will be posted at dun kayo sasagot. Alright. Okay. Just to give you a bird's eye view of how our discussion would look like, it is actually divided into four. First part is we're going to talk about a short history of how money began here in the country. The next would be the timeline of the Philippine Central Bank. Obviously, I didn't use BSP yet kasi during that time, wala pa naman tayong independent central bank kasi napakahaba ng history ng colonization ng ating bansa. No? It was just recently when the Banko Sentral was actually renamed to what we know it is right now. And then the third part would be the organizational structure of the BSP, which is available even sa website ng BSP. So far, wala pa namang changes, although we are now under a new administration. So as it is lang in discussion. And finally, the roles of the BSP under the new Central Bank Act. Ito, medyo technical yung magiging discussion natin dito. Most of them magiging first time sa pandinig ninyo. And heads up lang, dun sa ating end of chapter review questions, most of the questions would be topics or discussions included in that fourth section. So, mag-ready tayong lahat. Write notes if you must. Make sure you understand the topic very, very much. Ayun. Kasi pag hindi mo siya naintindihan, hanggang sa i-discuss na natin yung mga next topics, baka nalilito ka pa rin. So make sure, ulit-ulitin mo hanggang sa magets yung discussion. Alright? Okay. Let me begin this discussion with a picture of the 1949 Old Central Bank building. Alam nyo, a few years back, I was there sa Intramuros. Ano? So, the building is located in Intramuros, Manila. I just decided to take a photo with this building as the backdrop without me knowing na ito pala yung Old Central Bank ng ating bansa. Okay, it was built 4 years after the end of the World War II. It's a key milestone for the country since the aim is to really rebuild the country after the war. Okay, now, as we begin our discussion dun sa history, kung paano nagsimula ang pera dito sa Pilipinas, let's start during the pre-Hispanic period. As you can see, These are tiny gold bits. Ang tawag sa kanila ay piloncitos. They are the first recognized coinage in the Philippines, which circulated between the 9th and 12th century. And they emerged when increasing trade made barter inconvenient. Siguro kung naalala nyo pa during your araling panlipunan or your social studies subject in high school, we know that the first mode of buying and selling or trading in the past was barter. And so when the people discovered and realized that it's really inconvenient to carry your agricultural crops, your precious jewels, no, hindi kasi siya technically walang makakapagsabi kung ano yung value ng isang bagay before. So walang sistema, and it was during that period, no, when they realized na pwede naman palang gumamit ng ibang way to buy and sell things. Thus, the emergence of piloncitos and others gumamit din ng barter rings, but still it was made of gold. Again, this was during the pre-Hispanic period. And then, speaking of pre-Hispanic, no, during the Spanish era, we were under the colony or under the crown of Spain. And during that time, ang pera natin, one of the first banks that was established here in the country was the El Banco Español Filipino de Isabel II. So this is the a glimpse of how ito yung mga isa sa mga oldest, no, banknotes na nag-circulate during the Spanish period. This was issued or circulated in 1865. Okay, so this was the Queen of Spain on the face of the banknote. And then, aside from banknotes, of course, we had coins. Pero, heads up lang, no? Dito sa slides na pin-repare ko, most of the exhibits are in banknotes. Kasi napakarami kung isasama ko pa pati yung mga coins. But, just to give you an idea, no, aside from the banknotes, meron na rin coins na nagsisirculate sa Pilipinas, still under the Spanish regime. So, ang tawag ay cubs or makinas. Pero ang pinaka famous na tawag ay Dos Mundos. Siguro kung meron pa kayong mga lolo't lola na nakakwentuhan nyo before, they would frequently say the word Dos Mundos. FYI lang, no, pandagdag kaalaman, the famous word barya came from the Spanish word barilla, which means crude bronze or copper coin, usually equivalent to 1 centavo. And for sure, yung mga Indio na mga Pinoy, ang hawak lang nila madalas ay mga barya-barya. Ano ang tawag doon ay Dos Mundos. And this is also a 50 peso fuertes, but this one was circulated in 1883, still issued by the El Banco Español Filipino. This one is a 25 peso fuerte, issued by still, no, Banco Español Filipino in 1877. And during the revolutionary period, ayan, 1898, kasagsagan na to ng mga panahon na nakikipaglaban ng ating mga katipunero as headed by our first president, no, Emilio Aguinaldo. Although, syempre, mahabang kwento na yung mga naunang heroes natin, but during the revolutionary period, headed by former president Emilio Aguinaldo, or should I say, the first President of the Republic, Emilio Aguinaldo, as you can see here, meron siyang pangalan dito. They used these banknotes to circulate within their peers lang at hindi to alam ng mga Espanyol. Okay? So, this was issued in 1898. There was 1 peso and 5 peso revolutionary notes printed as Republica Filipina Papel Moneda de 1 peso and 5 pesos. And they were hand-signed. Imagine ninyo yun. Isa-isang pinirmahan ni na Pedro Paterno, Mariano Limhap, and Telesforo Chuidian. Yan. So, with the surrender of General Aguinaldo to the Americans, the currencies were withdrawn from circulation and they were declared as illegal form of currency. So, right after Aguinaldo surrendered to the Americans, no? Nawalan na po ng visa itong mga notes or currency na ito. And alam nyo ba, no? Did you know that after ruling for 333 years lang naman, ano, ng mga Spaniards, they finally left in 1898 after the revolution. And they were replaced by the Americans who stayed for 48 years. So natapos nga yung colonization ng mga Spaniards, pero ang pumalit naman ay mga Amerikano. Okay, ganun katagal silang nagstay dito sa Pilipinas. And speaking of which, no, the next exhibit that you would be seeing is called the American Colony Series. Obviously, no, dun pa lang sa design ng pera, naka-pattern na siya dun sa design ng dollar. Yun lang, the only difference is you can see the Philippine National Bank. Okay, so ang binigyan ng kapangyarihan ng gobyerno ng Amerika to print our Philippine counterpart currency is the Philippine National Bank. So ang nasa harapan ng ating pera noon ay si William Jones, kung saan nakapangalan yung Jones Bridge sa Maynila. Okay, and then the seal of the Philippine National Bank dun sa loob, dun sa likod. This note circulated in 1937. And the Americans instituted a monetary system for the Philippines based on gold and pegged the Philippine peso to the American dollar at the ratio of 2:1. So meaning two peso would be equivalent to a dollar. Okay, so the US Congress approved the Coinage Act for the Philippines in 1903. And this is an example of the 1941 10 peso banknote. Grabe, no? Akalain mo ba na once upon a time, we used the design of the US dollar as our own banknote in the country. Okay, so this is George Washington and the seal of the Philippine-American Commonwealth. Okay, ito yon. Okay, this one is a 200 peso banknote. In 1928 na to, so later na siya. 1928, at ang nag-issue na ay ang Bank of the Philippine Islands. So now you know, you have an idea kung ano ang oldest bank in the Philippines. Maliban pa dun sa mga Spanish banks, no, actually BPI ang pinakamatandang banko dito sa Pilipinas during the time of still, no, the American regime. This is one of the rarest banknotes ever issued during the American regime. Only 1,700 were printed and not so many have survived. A more worn out version of this banknote was sold at eBay for more than $1,000. So alam niyo na guys, if you have a rare bills that you still keep at home, no, itago nyo mabuti yan kasi you'll never know in the near future, bibili niya ng BSP sa inyo ng mas mahal pa. So itago nyo mabuti ang mga yan. Okay. So the renaming of the El Banco Español Filipino to Bank of the Philippine Islands in 1912 paved the way for the use of English from Spanish in all notes and coins issued up to 1933. So now you know that from the El Banco Español Filipino, ni-rename yung bank to the Bank of the Philippine Islands. That was only in 1912. And this is an example of the 20 peso banknote still during the American period. And 50 peso banknote 1920 series issued in the Philippines by the American government. So in front is Major General Henry W. Lawton, na kung saan pinangalan ng isang sikat na lugar sa Maynila, no, na Lawton. So it was actually renamed or named after this American general. And this one is 1 peso. Ayan. Kung meron pa kayong kopya nito, naku, Diyos ko, napakaswerte nyo. This is a rare banknote. Kasi American period pa to eh. Did you know? Ayan, speaking of American period pa rin tayo. Did you know that in 1907, under the American government, the Philippines experienced a leprosy problem? General William Taft was tasked to provide a solution to the health crisis by converting the Culion Island in Palawan as a leper colony. Okay, so FYI lang, in 1907, the Culion Island was converted into an isolation area where lepers, kasi noon wala pa talagang gamot at very infectious, no, parang COVID noon ng leprosy at yon. At because at dahil isolated yung island, ano, gumawa ng sariling pera itong isla na ito na kung saan pwedeng gamitin pambili at nire-recognize lang siya within the island. So, hindi mo siya pwedeng pambili sa ibang lugar, kundi doon lang sa islang yun. Okay, so extra trivia lang tayo. And after the Japanese after the American colonization, dumating yung World War II. Okay? During that time, when the Japanese invaded the Philippines, nagprint sila ng sariling pera. Kung nakikita mo, nakasulat dito is Japanese government. But it was in pesos. 'Di ba? Kung nakita niyo 1,000 pesos. Previously, dun sa mga naunang banknotes sa pinakita natin, pinakamalaki na yata yung 200. But 1,000 was a huge money during that time. And so, ang tawag sa pera nung panahon ng Hapon ay Mickey Mouse money kasi malaki siya pero yung value ay napakaliit lang. Okay? So, as inflation crept, in the Japanese printed banknotes in larger denominations. So that's the reason why they wanted to print in larger denominations kasi nga yung experience ng inflation sa bansa noon ay napakataas. So this bill is the last of the third series along with the 100 and 500 peso Japanese invasion money. It was printed just before their surrender in 1945. So these war notes had no backup reserves. Thus, Filipinos dubbed it as the Mickey Mouse money. So during the worst inflation in the Philippine history, Filipinos would go to the market laden with bayongs. As in, bayong-bayong na pera ang dala-dala nila with Mickey Mouse money inside those bayongs. Since one duck egg or balot costed 75 pesos. Imagine ninyo isang balot, 75 pesos. And a box of matches for more than 100 pesos. O, diba? Now you know, it's called the Mickey Mouse money or the Japanese money during the World War II period. Ayan, so these are more examples of the Japanese invasion money. Ayan, kung may namumukahan kayo dito na meron kayo sa bahay, it's a rare collectible item. Tago nyo mabuti. And of course, during the period of the war, no, nagkaroon tayo ng mga guerrilla notes. Para lang siyang mga stab. Kung titignan nyo, yung history ng bawat invasion sa Pilipinas, may kaakibat. Kung kanina, revolutionary period notes, ito naman, during the war, no, guerrilla notes. Okay, this was a 1 peso emergency guerrilla note. Kasi itong mga to, sa bundok nagtatago yung ating mga guerrilla soldiers. Okay? And of course, right after the war, no, nagkaroon tayo ng victory series, which is obviously printed with the word victory sa likod ng bawat banknote. Which means, this was the time na na-overcome ng Americans yung mga nag-invade na Japanese dito sa Pilipinas. Thus, no, it's called the Victory Series. Right. Okay. I'm sure yung iba sa inyo, baka merong pang naitago yung mga lolo't lola nyo na kopya nitong pera na to. Again, collector's item, I must say. Ayan. And then, after the Victory Series, meron na tayong 1949 English Series. Ayan. Wala pa tayong sariling ano natin dito ha. We were still under the American regime. As you can see, although we have key people or Filipino figures printed in the face of our money, but still, no, during this time, under pa rin tayo sa government ng Amerika. This was 120 pesos. Ayan, nakasulat na ay Central Bank of the Philippines. And then this is 50 pesos. I think this is tama. Half peso or can I say 50 centavos? Pero social, no? Half peso. Ayan, 5 pesos. 50 centavos, 20 centavos. Okay. And then, after the 1949 English series, ayan, we now move forward to the Filipino series. Ayan, medyo hawig na siya nung mga naabutan ko pang pera. Pero hindi ko, wala na ako naabutan na ganito, ha? Ayan, so it's called the Filipino series. Okay. And now, ito naabutan ko pa to, no? Yung New Design series. And then, fast forward, no? New Generation Series. Ito na yung naabutan ninyong pera. And then, recently din, no, nagkaroon ng tinatawag na Enhanced New Generation Series just to make sure na mas maraming security features yung ating mga banknotes. And then, finally, no, the latest is this one. This year lang po ito ni-release ng Bangko Sentral. They are now called the polymer banknotes because of the materials used sa pag-print nitong 1,000 peso bill. So far, yung polymer banknote natin is yung 1,000 peso bill para mas tumagal yung buhay at mas maraming security features. So, alongside this are the new coins which are now in circulation na yung 20 peso and enhanced 5 peso coin. Okay, now, if kayo ang tatanungin ko, no, so which design of our previous and present currency did you find most interesting? So, and ba yung sa pre-Spanish, oh, no, yung mga gold bits? Was it during the Spanish era, the Revolutionary Period, the American Colony Series, yan, yung mga mukhang dollar, the Japanese invasion money, if you've paid attention to the details of how the currency back then was designed, kitang-kita mo no, Japanese inspired talaga yung design ng pera. Guerrilla notes, the Victory series ba, the English series, the Filipino series, the New Design series, the New Generation series, or the Enhanced New Generation series. So I would be asking that kapag ka tayo ay nag-meet na dun sa ating online discussion. So, magsulat na kayo ng answer nyo regarding this question. Then you also have to say bakit yun yung napili ninyo, no? Alright. So, as your individual activity, you will be seeing a post on your respective group channel. So, you have to look for an old Philippine currency still being kept at your house. So, meron ba? So, if yes, you need to take a selfie with that banknote or post a photo of that bill or coin na dapat kasama or naka-attach yung pangalan mo at yung section mo, or if you would also like, no, a picture of that coin or that banknote alongside with your TSU ID. Just so I know na sa'yo talaga yon at ikaw ang kumuha. So this is gonna be your first individual activity in relation to the history of money here in the Philippines. Okay? Now, for the next subtopic, pag-uusapan na natin yung brief timeline ng Philippine Central Bank. Okay. During the Commonwealth period na tayo, no, kasi this was the only time na meron na tayong sariling central bank, although the monetary policy or the monetary system was still under the American government. So, ibig sabihin, sumusunod lang tayo dun sa pinapatupad ng Amerika. Okay? So, this was in 1935 to 1941. The monetary system of the Philippines was administered by the Department of Finance and National Treasury. With that being said, during our first meeting, I told you, no, na ang monetary policies natin, ang nag-i-impose nyan ay ang ating central bank. But during that period, no, yung Commonwealth period, ang in charge pa sa ating monetary system ay ang Department of Finance at National Treasury. At hindi pa po ang central bank. So during that time, the Philippines was on the exchange standard using the dollar. Okay, so hindi po ginto ang basihan ng ating exchange, kundi US dollar. Kasi ito ay after na ng World War II. Okay? And the dollar was backed by 100% gold reserve as the standard currency. So us in the Philippines, we were using the dollar and we were not using gold because the dollar was already backed by gold. Okay, kasi magiging redundant kung yung exchange natin dollar, tapos yung US dollar na gamit natin ay backed up na ng gold. Right? So that was in 1935 to 1941. In 1939, we or the Filipino lawmakers passed a bill. Pansinin niyo tong mabuti ha. Yung ating mga mambabatas na Pilipino nagpasa ng batas. Tama ba? Naipapasa na, no? Oo, nagpasa ng isang batas na kung saan we would like to establish our own central bank. That was in 1939. Unfortunately, the president then, Franklin D. Roosevelt, rejected this proposition. Again, we were still under the Commonwealth of the U.S. We had to ask yung blessing ng Amerika bago tayo magpatupad ng batas. So as early as 1939, our lawmakers were already making an effort to establish our own central bank. So, napurnada siya. And in 1944, this was during the Japanese occupation, there was a second attempt to pass this law, but the American liberalization forces aborted its implementation. So, in short, dalawang beses nagkaroon ng attempt na humingi o maisabatas na magkaroon na ng sariling central bank ang Pilipinas. And it was only in 1946, okay? It was in 1946, as instructed by the newly elect President Manuel Rojas, the former Finance Secretary Miguel Cuaderno Sr., as you can see here, dun sa lower picture, they drew the first charter of the central bank. So a central bank will serve as a way for the Philippines to shift from the dollar exchange standard to a managed currency system. And it was only in 1948 when the charter draft was submitted to the Congress. Kung mapapansin nyo, 1939 na pornada, 1944 na pornada. So after the war, 1946, newly elected President Manuel Rojas, doon pa lang nagdraw ng charter. It was his initiative to ask the former finance secretary to draw a charter for the central bank. And it took, 2 years? Kasi it was only in 1948 when this charter was submitted to the Congress. So, napakatagal na journey towards having our own central bank, ano? And finally, in 1948, ito yung sinasabi nating iba yung nagsaing, iba yung kumain. Kasi noong 1948, pagkaupo ni President Elpidio Quirino, ang gagawin na lang niya ay pipirmahan yung batas para masabing meron na nga tayong sariling central bank. So it was in 1948 that this was a definitive step of having full national sovereignty. And kanina, no, yung pinakita kong picture, it was in 1949 yung na-establish yung ating old central bank building. And in 1987, no, the central bank became the central monetary authority of the country. Kasi Previously, it was the job of the Department of Finance and the National Treasury, but then in 1987, finally, no, ibinigay na yung authority sa ating central bank. So anything that has something to do with the policies regarding monetary policy, lahat shinift na to our central bank. Okay, now fast forward to 1993. It was actually President Fidel Ramos who signed into law Republic Act number 7653, which is the new Central Bank Act. And that happened on June 14 of 1993. So the name of the Central Bank was officially changed to Banco Central ng Pilipinas. So recently lang ho siya, no, 1993. This new law gave fiscal and administrative autonomy to BSP. So the way that we see the Banco Central right now is because of the RA number 7653 or the new Central Bank. Okay, so thanks to former President Fidel Ramos. And latest updates, no? I think na-mention ko na to during our introductory meeting dun sa ating primer. This last 2021, the Banco Central ng Pilipinas and the Basis Conversion and Development Authority or BCDA signed a contract for lease of a parcel of land at the New Clark City's National Government Administrative Center or the NCC-NGAC in Capas, Tarlac, which will become the site for the new BSP complex. So, di ba? Can you imagine a more updated facility for our central bank? Actually, nai-excite ako kasi mas mapapalapit na sa atin yung ating BSP complex, and it's gonna produce a lot of opportunities for local employment, especially here in the province of Tarlac. Okay, now we go to the third subtopic for this discussion. Nandito na tayo sa organizational structure ng ating central bank. I have mentioned previously that the head of the BSP is called the governor, which is eto yun, ano? Ang ating current governor right now is si Mr. Philip Medalla. Ayan. BSP head natin prior to him was Benjamin Jokno. Okay. So, above the governor, as you can see, no, meron pa tayong tinatawag na monetary board. Just like in the corporate setting, yung head ng kumpanya or yung CEO, eh meron pang governing body above the CEO, or in the case of the BSP, of the governor, meron pang mas powerful body na nag-overlook at nag-oversee ng operations ng central bank, and we call them the monetary board. So under the monetary board, nag-re-report directly yung office of the secretary of the monetary board. Meron din siyang general counsel and legal services, and of course the internal audit office. That these offices or these departments report directly to the monetary board and not the governor. Okay, kung nakita nyo, itong line na to means directly reporting to the monetary board. And the governor, as you can see here, reports directly to the monetary board. So meaning, kung powerful na si governor, mas powerful of course si monetary board. Kasi hindi pwedeng magpasa ng policies ang BSP governor without the approval of the monetary board. Okay, and these departments, actually 12 sila, these 12 departments under the supervision of the BSP governor, let's give it, siguro mabilis lang na parang run through, okay? So we have the financial markets. Under the financial markets, dyan pag-uusapan yung reserves management, domestic market operations department, market research and surveillance, etc., etc. So there's a department for financial markets. And then we have strategic communication and advocacy. dito yung pinaka-educational section ng BSP. Kasi kung makikita nyo, meron dito Consumer Protection and Market Conduct Office, Economic and Financial Learning Office, Communication Office, Corporate Affairs Office, and then we have the Investor Relations Office. And aside from the Education Department, meron siyang BSP Research Academy. Usually nagpo-post si BSP every year, call for research presentations from schools. Ayan. Kasi na, may mga partner institutions na rin ng BSP when it comes to creating researches for in aid of policy making ng BSP. Okay. So, it's open now to everyone. Hindi na lang siya inclusive sa mga miyembro ng BSP. So, ang sikreto na kasi ngayon ano is collaboration among stakeholders, various stakeholders kasi dahil BSP is a public concern, no? So inopen na siya sa public. Office of Systemic Risk Management. Ayan, hindi lang po mga private companies ang nagpa-practice ng risk management. So even the BSP has its own department specifically for the issues of risk management. And then we have Technology and Digital Innovation Office. So lahat ng IT related, andyan po. Office of Strategy Management. It's because very dynamic ang central bank. Lahat ng mga nakikita nating advancements when it comes to technology, hindi pwedeng magpikit mata ang ating central bank. So when you say strategy, kasi these are long-term projects of the central bank. And then we have Risk and Compliance Office, Human Resource and Organization Department. And then finally, dito sa bandang baba, ano, we have the Monetary and Economics Sector. We have the Financial Supervision Sector, Corporate Services Sector, and then Payments and Currency Management Sector. Lahat ng mga key offices under BSP has something to do with the roles of the Banko Sentral ng Pilipinas. So later, dun sa last subtopic natin, pag-uusapan natin, yung mga roles na yun at may kinalaman itong organizational structure, the way it is presented to us right now, it has something to do with the functions of the BSP. Kasama na dyan yung financial supervision. Kung makikita nyo, ito yung may pinakamalaking malaking department na pakaraming sub-offices pa. It's because napakaraming trabaho itong financial supervision. Okay? And then we have regional operations. There are certain offices spread out sa buong Pilipinas. We have the BSP North Luzon Regional Office. And then we have the BSP South Luzon Regional Office, BSP Visayas, BSP Mindanao, and then BSP Greater Manila. Okay, so these are regional offices. Itong BSP North Luzon, ito nakita ko na to in person. This one is located in La Union. BSP Visayas is located in Cebu. So, yung mga yung nakita ko na. And speaking of the organizational structure of the central bank, and speaking of monetary board, FYI lang, no, gusto ko lang ipakita sa inyo, top 15 highest paid government officials in 2021. Kung titignan natin, napakarami ng mga officials na to coming from the central bank. Number one on the list is the BSP governor, no, Benjamin Jokno. And then the rest, makita nyo, BSP monetary board member, BSP monetary board member, top 10, actually hanggang 11, coming from the BSP monetary board. Ganyan kalaki yung compensation nila. It's because it comes with the stress from the work that they are responsible of. Hindi madali ang mag-operate ng central bank. Hence, so sana naman, no? Sana naman worth it yung binabayad nating compensation through our taxpayers' money dito sa ating head ng central bank. So you would be surprised, no? Ala, ganun pala yun, ano? Napakalaki ng kanilang compensation with the work that they do. Okay, now we have come to the last portion of our discussion, which is the roles of the BSP according to the new Central Bank Act. Okay, so konting tiyaga na lang po sa pakikinig kasi nandito na tayo sa last part ng discussion. Alright, so the first is liquidity management. And so when we say liquidity management, dito na papasok itong contractionary tsaka expansionary policy which I introduced to you during our first meeting. Okay, so yung ating monetary policies, may kinalaman siya in making sure that there is enough money supply. There is enough cash circulating in our economy. Okay? So when we say contractionary policy means, kung nakikita niyo itong symbolism na ginamit ng BSP, ay gripo. No? When you say liquidity kasi no, tubig, madaling i-convert back into cash. Or let's just say, cash per se, pinaka-liquid na asset is cash. So just to make sure that there is enough liquidity and there is not overflowing naman. So pag sinabi mong sobra, there's too much money circulating in the economy. Pag sinabi mong kulang, no, very very dry yung liquidity ng ekonomiya. At meron din naman yung sakto lang, ibig sabihin well-managed. So there is a mechanism that the central banks are using. So hindi lang sa Pilipinas ito, even in foreign central banks, they also use contractionary and expansionary policy. So we can think of monetary policy as the faucet, so gripo, BSP as the person who controls the faucet, ito yung kamay, and the water as the supply of money in the economy. So when there is too much money in the economy, supporting overall demand for goods and services, which in turn, it increases inflationary pressures. So, ang tanong ko sa inyo before, no? So sa tingin nyo yung pagpiprint ng maraming pera ba can reduce poverty in a particular country? We said that the answer is false. Kasi pagka sobra-sobra, no, there's too much money circulating in an economy, it derives or it drives inflationary pressures. Nagmamahal yung mga goods simply because masyadong malaki yung demand, maraming pera yung tao. So, the BSP would tighten the faucet, kailangan higpitan, to reduce the money supply. So, in short, with that being said, no, from that part of the paragraph, alam mo na that monetary policies would mean to reduce or increase the money supply in a country for a particular period. Okay, so isa siyang panghigpit ng sinturon. So this action dampens demand which could lead to lower inflation. So meaning kapag ka lesser na yung money na nagsi-circulate in an economy, it can lower inflation. Okay, so paano ginagawa ng central bank yung mga tinatawag nating contractionary policies? So one way of doing that is higher interest rates. So, by driving interest rates, pwede pala nating sabihin na kayang kontrolin ng central bank yung money supply sa ating ekonomiya. So, when we talk of higher interest rates, guys, pag sinabi nating mataas ang ini-impose na interest rate ng central bank for this period, meaning walang masyadong uutang. Okay, bakit? Kasi walang tao o walang negosyo ang gustong mangutang sa tuwing mataas ang interest rate. Okay? So therefore, pag mataas ang interest rates, mas kokonti ang nangungutang. So pagka mas konti ang nangungutang, ano sa tingin nyo? There is more savings. Okay? Kasi nga, pag sinabi mong kinokontract mo yung economy, binabawasan mo yung nag-circulate na pera sa ekonomiya. Okay? So, mataas ang interest rate, mas kukonti ang nangungutang, mas maraming nagsisave. Bakit mas maraming nagsisave? Kasi kung ikaw si depositor, mas gusto mo pag mataas ang interest sa banko. So, yung nangungutang, kukonte, pero mas maraming maiinggan yung mag-save kasi mas mataas yung interest rates. And so, when there are people more saving sa mga financial institutions natin, mas kukonte yung spending. Why? Ibig sabihin, instead of buying things na hindi naman kailangan, ikikip mo na lang yung pera at dadalin sa banko. Gets ba natin? So, meaning, when we say contractionary policies of the central bank, it means ways on which the money supply circulating in the country is tightened or it is lessened. Kumbaga, ito mas maganda pang illustration. Ano? If you can imagine a room full of water, para tanggalin yung tubig, kailangan mo ng map. Pang-map ng tubig. No? Imamap mo yung floor para bumalik yung tubig dun sa timba. So, yung map na yon ay nagsisilbing contractionary tool. Kasi binabalik mo yung tubig, pabalik dun sa map, papunta dun sa timba. Again, ulitin natin, contractionary policies, tinataasan ng central bank yung interest rates. Kasi gustong bawasan yung mga nangungutang at ini-encourage na mag-save yung mga tao para there is less spending. So therefore, babalik sa ating mga banko yung perang nakasirculate or naka-spread out sa ating economy. On the other hand, when we say expansionary policy, there is too little money in the economy which dampens overall demand for goods and services. So therefore, kung kanina inflation, this time walang demand for goods and services. So anong gagawin ng BSP? It will loosen the faucet to expand money supply. So kung kanina pag contractionary policy, higher interest rates, this time pag expansionary policy, lower interest rates. Why? Pagka mas mababa, no, ang interest rate sa banko, mas maraming gustong mangutang. And sino ba yung mga usually nangungutang? Yung mga kapitalista. Kung hindi man kapitalista, yung mga gustong bumili ng sasakyan, gustong bumili ng bahay, kasi mas mura yung mas mura yung loans, mas madaling mag-access ng funds. So therefore, there is more lending and borrowing. Okay, so hindi lang sa mga businessmen, hindi lang sa corporate, kundi pati mga individual borrowers. So if this happens, mas kukonti yung nagsisave. Kasi bakit ka magdi-deposit kung very minimal lang yung interest rate? So what you would do, there is now more spending. So when there is more spending, mas nag-i-expand yung money supply sa ating ekonomiya. Okay, gets po ba natin? So pagka-contractionary policy, binabalik ng central bank yung money supply pabalik sa mga banks. And expansionary, naglo-loosen up yung BSP para to encourage more spending in the economy. So tuwing kailan ina-adapt yan, ma'am, depende sa circumstance ng ekonomiya. So for example, during the pandemic, no, halos hindi gumalaw yung ating interest rate. It was only roughly at 1%. Hindi siya nag-increase, hindi rin siya nag-decrease. So just to make sure na encourage pa rin mangutang yung mga tao. Actually, yung 1% is very low na as compared to where we are now at 3.75%. So, alam mo na, pagka nagtataas ng interest rate ang banko, no, it means kinukontract kasi there's too much money circulating in the economy and we want to encourage businessmen, we want to encourage capitalists to avail of loans to open up the economy, 'di ba? Kailangan na magbukas ng negosyo, kailangan ng mag-create ng more employment and so kailangan babaan ng ating central bank yung ating interest rates. So ganun din if we want to expand, we want people to if we want people to start spending again, No, kailangan nating babaan talaga yung interest rates. But if we want to encourage businessmen to save, to invest in the country, we must increase interest rates. But the other side of that is that there is less lending and there is less spending. Alright? Okay, so I hope malinaw na sa atin ano ang difference ng contractionary policy at ng expansionary policy. Depende po yan sa circumstance na nangyayari sa isang ekonomiya for a certain period of time. Okay, now that we know what liquidity management is, contractionary tsaka expansionary policy, we move to the currency issue. Walang ibang authorized na mag-print ng pera dito sa Pilipinas kundi ang central bank lang. So when we say currency issue, we're talking of printing of money and minting of coins. And aside from that, siguro dun sa next chapter na lang natin pag-uusapan, no, where we would be discussing how the BSP retires money. So hindi lang nag-i-issue, kundi pati pagre-retire ng currency. And then lender of last resort, this is only applicable to banks. Okay, so si BSP ay ang lender of last resort ng mga yung mga recognized financial intermediaries na may kinalaman sa banking. Okay, and then also financial supervision. They are the ones who supervises the operations and make sure that the banks are complying with the requirements of the BSP. Thus, merong department kanina allotted for compliance. Okay? So, kasama po yan sa trabaho ng central bank. And of course, management of foreign currency reserves. This is an extra topic na pag-uusapan natin na kung saan reserves lang ang pag-uusapan at center ng ating discussion. Medyo madugo ito, pero magiging very interesting for sure. And ito, hindi alam ng marami na aside from interest rates, ang nagdidikta rin ng exchange rate ay ang central bank. So everyday na nagre-report ang mga news outlets, whether it be newspaper, internet, or TV, no, radio, lahat ng news coming from the central bank. Kasi isa lang ho ang central authority natin na pwede mag-determine ng ating exchange rate. Okay? And next is being the banker, financial advisor, official depository of the government. Okay, ulitin natin. Hindi po lender ng government, ha? Banker, financial advisor, official depository ng ating gobyerno. Aside from these mentioned transactions, wala na hong ibang pwedeng i-cater na service ang ating central bank sa ating government. It can only serve as an advisor and an official depository. So not only the government but also political subdivisions and instrumentalities and government-owned and controlled corporations or what we call as GOCCs. Okay? And then, aside from these mentioned roles, meron tayong tinatawag na payments and settlements. Kung mapapansin nyo, no, lahat ng, kung mapapansin nyo right now with just the use of GCash, PayMaya, we are able to flawlessly execute our payments online. And even though, no, ang mga online banks or online wallets na to ay privately owned, they are still regulated and supervised by the Banco Central. So meaning, lahat ng pamamaraan na kung saan nagbabayad at nagsisettle ang mga citizens ng Pilipinas, basta kailangan dumaan ang pera sa kanila, kailangan ay regulated at supervised ng Banko Sentral. Bakit? Because it promotes accountability and it would lessen the factor na pwedeng ma-abuse yung public trust. Okay? So meaning, ang BSP pala, aside from all of this list here, part ng kanyang mandato yung pag-oversee ng payment and settlement system ng Pilipinas. Okay? So, operator of the real-time gross settlement system known as PhilPass. Kung mapapansin nyo, pag bumili kayo sa, let's say for example, sa department store, using your credit card or your debit card, it would easily reflect, no, yung purchase mo pag lumabas na yung receipt, no, ibig sabihin settled na, nagbayad ka na at magre-reflect na yon dun sa pinagbilhan mo, which is yung sa department store. Also, no, if I may share, nung umuwi dito yung sister ko, nagpunta kami sa isang malaking appliance center dito sa Tarlac, and she was using her foreign credit card. Okay? So, the moment she swiped that credit card, okay, lumabas yung receipt, nag-message sa kanya yung bank niya abroad, saying at nag-indicate na nag-purchase siya during this time. So, nag-reflect ka agad dun sa banko niya abroad, and then nag-reflect ka agad dun sa system nung pinagbilhan naming appliance center. Okay, so it's the real-time gross settlement system. So, sino ang nag-ooperate niyan? It is the Banco Central. Okay? Ang galing, ano? Kala niyo ba walang, ano? Walang heads behind this system? So, we now know it's the central bank. And it is also a provider of credit facilities to banks as a lender of last resort. So, itong credit facilities natin, there is a certain topic na pag-uusapan natin itong mga credit facilities na to na pinuprovide ng central bank. And only the central bank can provide. Wala nang iba. Hindi po ang gobyerno, kundi central bank lang. Overseer of the payments and settlement system. So, aside from siya yung nag-ooperate, siya din ang may oversight powers ng ating settlement system. And then, it also uses its own RTGS or Real-Time Gross Settlement System. And siya rin, no, ang nag-initiate ng changes or reforms for the payment system. As you can see, before, over-the-counter pa ang pagbabayad sa mga banks. If nagbabayad ka ng BIR liabilities mo every quarter, kailangan mo pang pumunta at pumila sa mga registered banks or partners ng BIR bago ka makapag-settle ng tax liabilities mo. Right now, with the use of technology, you know, the use of PayMaya, the use of online banking, we can now pay and settle our bills online. And sino ang nag-initiate ng changes at reforms? It's the central bank. And so, in the future, kapag ka may mga bago ng mechanisms on how to settle our bills, it will always be the BSP who will regulate and approve these new reforms. And speaking of which, alam ko, at some time nung 2019, sobrang sumikat talaga yung Laika Gems to the point na pinopromote na talaga siya ng mga artista. Diba? So, lumitaw itong suspension dahil hindi pala accredited yung Laika sa BSP. No, may kinalaman na kasi siya dito sa real-time gross settlement system. So, anything na may kinalaman sa pagpo-purchase, pagsisettle, pagbabayad, na nag-ooperate dito sa Pilipinas, kailangan dumaan sa scrutiny ni Banco Central. It's because involve ang public trust. Kaya involve ang pera ng tao. Another example, ito, very recently lang, no, June 15, 2022. So, a group asks the BSP to probe, suspend crypto exchange named Binance. So, if you're using or you're familiar with Binance, dahil nga nauso na yung mga crypto exchanges dito sa Pilipinas, biglang kino-question yung legality ng operations ng Binance dito sa Pilipinas. But the question is, hanggang saan lang ba yung dapat na scope ng regulation ng BSP? Kasi if we try to look at how Binance is operating, hindi naman siya payment and settlement platform. It is actually a crypto exchange. So, ang tanong, covered pa rin ba siya ng BSP? So, this is still in the, it's still in the talks. Hindi pa siya final. So, even si SEC, pinapacheck ito. So, even si BSP right now, china-challenge kung dapat bang bigyan ng license to operate ang Binance dito sa Philippines. Okay, and with that, that ends my discussion for Chapter 1. It's just an introduction to central banking. This is the scope of how the central bank operates in the Philippines at least. So, meron tayong mga bagong natutunan regarding central bank, regarding liquidity management, specifically contractionary and expansionary policy. Magagamit natin itong pinag-aralan natin dito sa mga susunod pang mga topics na i-discuss natin under midterm topics. And with that, I thank you everyone for finishing this lecture and hanging until the very last minute of this discussion. I hope meron tayong mga na-pick up at natutunan. Marami pa tayong pag-uusapan sa mga susunod na discussion. Right? See you on our online discussion. The link for the end of the chapter review questions will be posted on our feed. Right. Thank you, everyone.